I'm Tim Haynes, the master of the Skinners Company this year. And I'm sure that Sir Robert Bilston would be looking down delighted that here we are together, merchant tailors and skinners and friends, at this joint history meeting. It's only taken us a few hundred years. Yes, that's great. I was going to make a joke about sixes and sevens and the ticket allocation, but my maths isn't good enough to work out whether that's to our advantage or the merchant tailors, whether we're 100 tickets and 50-50. So perhaps that's what we should be, six equal. Anyway, it's great to see you all this evening. I think we're in for a fascinating set of talks, and I'm going to hand over without further ado to Hugh Carson, the Arch Chairman of our History Society. Hugh.
Thank you, Master. Well, yes, it was 539 years ago, and I wonder whether he's looking down on us now, half a millennium later, to see how we get on. So far, so good, anyway. But I must thank the fitness staff first for all the work that they've already done for us for tonight, and the merchant tailors as well. And ours, the Skinner staff, but in particular I'd like to mention Ellie Wilson, Joe Timms, Emma Clay, and Paul Richards for coordinating and doing all the administration, otherwise it wouldn't have taken place. I would also like to thank James Twain, who is my opposite number, for his support and encouragement as the chairman of his history committee, and also to the members of both history committees for their support for this function. But the only thing I have now to do is to welcome our two speakers, our two very distinguished speakers, both of them professors, both of them leading medieval historians, not only in London, but throughout the country. And first of all, we welcome Professor Matthew Davies, who is Executive Dean and Professor of Urban History, Executive Dean of the Humanities and Social Sciences Department at Birkbeck College, London, and Professor Caroline Barron, Professor Emerita at Royal Holloway College, and President of the British Association for Local History. We are very lucky to have these two distinguished speakers speaking this evening, and I hope you enjoy it. So over without any further ado to Carol.
Originally, the city was governed predominantly by the aldermen, who which was in charge of a ward. But gradually, the city company had come to have a role in the government of the city. In the 14th century, there was a period in which the common council of the city was elected by the different crafts. But they fought and squabbled so much that they had to go back to the more neutral wards. So that experiment failed. However, city companies continuously, in the 15th century, began to be used by the court of aldermen, the mayor of aldermen, for certain civic things, raising money, raising troops to defend the city on certain occasions, and various activities of this kind. And they also, what was also happening in the 15th century, is a development of civic ceremonial. It's much more notable in the 15th century, emphasis on heraldry, emphasis on processions, on livery, all that aspect of city life takes off very much in the 15th century. And as these two, particularly the second, the ceremonial aspect, as this develops, it made the ordering of the companies, in what order they were to possess or to be called, provide men, or whatever it was, much more significant. However, the evidence, I have to say, for disputes between the skinners and the tailors is very slight. Matthew found one instance, I think I'm right, Matthew is saying, in which reference in the merchant tailors' accounts in 1464-5, when a man called Henry Clough, who was a tailor, was sent to Newgate for uttering, I quote, dishonest words about the craft of skinners. This is, of course, before the Lowestoft War, which came in 1484. So, and I can find no evidence of this disputing of that behavior. People tell me, oh, you know, they were pushing each other out of barges and tipping each other off their horses. I can't find any evidence of that. I think that's part, I'm afraid, of the myth. I consulted Stephen O'Connor, who is reading the journals of the city for the reign of Richard III, which is the reign in which the Lowestoft War was made, and he can find no evidence of any disputes between the tailors and the skinners. And Manny Bolton, who's here tonight, who's looked at the 15th century records of skinners, there seems to be no evidence of disputes with the tailors. So, but clearly, the ordering of crafts, the orders in which they appeared, did matter. And I think we have to distinguish between, there are lots of lists of crafts in the city records where they needed to raise money or they needed to some other activity in which crafts were associated with the companies. But they tend to be varied in the order in which their names are listed. And for example, if I give you a couple of examples, in 1445, where all the crafts had to contribute to peacekeeping in the city, top of the list are the butchers. Or in 1447, contributions to the completion of the Guildhall Chapel, the city of hostelers or innkeepers on the top of the list. So these utilitarian lists could come in any order, depending really on who is present or who first came into the court before the court of aldermen, or who was known to be willing to act. Of course, when you have procedural lists, lists which relate to more ceremonial occasions, then perhaps the ordering becomes more significant. And I'll give you two examples. In September 1453, there was a group of barges that were organized to meet Queen Margaret of Anjou when she came to marry Henry VI. And the ordering there, I'll give it to you now, it's laid down in the journals of the court of Aldermen, Court of Common Council. Mercers, drapers, grocers, fishmongers, goldsmiths, skinners, tailors, haberdashers, vintners, each is to have one barge. The leather sellers and the saddlers are to share the barge, but that is the ordering. Or give you another example, again, these are all ceremonial occasions. 21st of April, 1482, the crafts ride, this time on horseback, to meet the young king, Edward V. Very short reign, as we know. Going to that mode. Anyway, end of the fifth. And this is the 21st of April, 1482. The ordering then is the goldsmiths first, then mercers, drapers, grocers, fishmongers. Each of those is to provide 30 men for this procession. The skinners is to provide 20 when was the company first perhaps got its charter, first appears in the city records. Actually, that doesn't work because city companies got charters at very different times and they don't affect the order in which they appear in these ceremonial lists. What obviously matters is wealth. And not just corporate wealth, that is the hall or the properties that the company owns or their almshouses or indeed their plate, but rather I think the individual wealth of individual members of the company. And there's one thing I think it's worth remembering is that in order to be an alderman in the 15th century, you had to attend the court of aldermen probably 2-3 times a week. We didn't attend all the meetings, but you were a mayor who attended every single meeting, and almost always it's 100% attendance. I did attendance charts for all the meetings of the court of aldermen in 1416 and 1463, and you can see that it was a very onerous task to be a alderman. That means you couldn't be somebody like a tailor or that time sitting, as it were, cross-legged on your head sewing. You couldn't be an armourer or a butcher or a poacher because you had to be at your job earning money. You had to earn money in ways that allowed you to be absent from your work. And that usually meant that you were a trader of some kind, an overseas trader company. And that is why, in a sense, the court ordering is made up, it was in the 15th century, of people from the merchant trading craft because they had the time to do it. So you get the people who were present on the occasion when the bills to the war was made on the 10th of April, 1484. There were the court order at that time was made up of 34 men. Mercers 7 people, drapers 5, goldsmiths and grocers 3 each, the sorters 2, and 1 each, a tailor, skinner, ironmonger, and haberdasher. Notice there are no farmers and no vendors. Those were companies that had a great, were suffering a sort of recession, particularly the vendors because of the loss of Gascony and the interruption to the wine trade in 1453. So, there's an interesting idea. I did a count of how many mayors up to that date these different companies had produced. And the leading companies were the grocers, who produced 63 mayors, the mercers, 62, the drapers, 41, the fishmongers, 33, the goldsmiths, 10, the skinners, 7, the vintners, 2, the ironmongers, 2, and one sorter, the first sorter, 1475. Robert Wilson was the first haberdasher mayor, and that's in this year, and the tailors didn't have a mayor until 1498, which we hear more about, I think. Now, why are the skinners there? Because the skinners have two elements. They have both a trading element, people who imported furs from the Baltic, and therefore were considerable merchants, and the artisan element, the people who actually sewed the furs and put them together. So they had, as it were, the tailors only had an artisan element, but they developed a mercantile element in the 15th century. In fact, they had a big fight with the drapers about that because they wanted to enter the trade union. And they managed to do that. Hence their significance for the tailors in becoming the merchant tailors, because that emphasized the fact they had both a mercantile, as it were, trade union and an artisan element. So it's an interesting situation. And then we get to the award of 1484. And I'm going to suggest to you, not that the mayor imposed upon the war, in fact, two companies an agreement. I'm going to suggest that they actually took their dispute to the mayor for his resolution. William, what's the form of the entry in the city's journals, which I'm going to look at possibly, says, that actually, it notes that the judgment was not forced upon them, but I'm suggesting they chose to take, I quote, the variance and controversy moved and had between them to the arbitration of Robert Bilston, the mayor, and the alderman. So they're taking their dispute. 12 clergy, which is what many individuals and companies did do as a mayor and alderman at this time. And the actual award says that the skinners are to invite the tailors to dinner with them at their common hall on the vigil of Corpus Christi being the great festival that the skinners celebrate, and to make them an open dinner. Now I'm very interested in that word, open dinner. I don't know what it means. I'd be interested to know what they are using, an open dinner. Actually, when I read it first, I thought it said a keep-on dinner. It doesn't, it's an open dinner. And the tailors are to attend that dinner unless they have a reasonable excuse. And the tailors are to invite the skinners, and the same on the eve of their festival, feast of St. John the Baptist. Then it goes on to say that the master awards the fellowship of the skinners are to have preeminence of going up a four in processions 1 year, and the same awards the fellowship of the tailors to have the preeminence of going a four in processions another year, beginning in the year of Easter. Only when one of the company produces a mare, then his company takes precedence over all other companies in the year of his merit. But notice there's no reference to the actual placing. It just says that a present doesn't say seven, six, in fact, you have a number of various listings of city companies after the Wilson Award in which they don't always come sixth and seventh. They have different places in the listing. The final definitive listing of the ordering of the companies comes in January 1516, so quite a long time after. Again, I looked at the copy in the city journals, and that gives the ordering, which is, I believe, the ordering which is observed. Mercers, grocers, drapers, fishmongers, goldsmiths. And then there's a bracket, skinners and tailors, and it says, according to the ordinance thereof, made in the time of the mayoralty of Master Goldsmith. And then it goes on, haberdashers, soldiers, ironmongers, vintners, shearmen, who became later the cloth wearers. I have to say, I'm embarrassed to say, the skinners challenged that decision on the 17th of January 1521, and they said that ruling only applied to processions and not other goings and things like that. And I'm afraid the mayor would have said, well, it applies to every procession and meeting, and the skinners had to, as it were, with a chair between their legs, etc. So, I want to show you a Matthew, one slide. Right. I want to show you this slide because I think it's very interesting and because it's not very well known. In fact, I don't think many people know. It is actually a manuscript in Trinity College, Cambridge. It's a list from the 1480s. The manuscript is a kind of notebook, a collection of documents useful for somebody who's going to hold office in the city at home. It comes from the household probably of Thomas Cook, who was a draper, or possibly a fishmonger who was Stephen Forster. We're not sure who actually owned it, but if you see here, you see the listing of the companies listed alphabetically. So this, I think this list predates the Wilson Award, in fact. But I think it's such a beautiful list, it's so beautifully written, and the person has put them alphabetically, and then alongside, he's put the numbering of the order. And that is, I think, a list, I don't think that's very well known, this list of the ordering, probably predating the Bilston Award of 1484. And it lists 75 crafts, which is really an interesting and much larger number than we normally think of. So that's what I want to offer to you, that the Bilston Award arose out of a need for organisation, and they wanted the mayor to resolve a dispute, but not because they were fighting each other. Thank you.
Arthur, Godfrey, Guillaume, and Charlemagne, and then three pagans, Agamemnon, Hector, Julius Caesar, and also three Jewish figures from the Bible, Joshua, David, and Judah Maccabee. So this is a very comprehensive European art in medieval times, literature, starting in the 14th century. Well, by the end of the 16th century, we have a really interesting publication by someone called Richard Johnson, who we don't know much about at all, a very obscure figure. But he published a book called The Nine Words of London. And this has a very long title, which I think is worth reading out. The Nine Words of London is explaining the honourable exercise of arms, the virtues of the valiant, and the memorable attempts of a magnanimous mind. Pleasant for gentlemen, not unseen for magistrates, and most profitable for apprentices. So I think there are a couple of elements to draw out of that. The first is this idea of the honourable exercise of arms. It's about chivalry, it's about the values associated with chivalry and military exploits. So that's a theme that runs through the Nine Words of London, and the reason why they're selected, and I'll show some of the names in a moment. Then the second thing is about the audience that this is intended for. The magistrates are the rulers of the towns and cities, and of course rulers and the leaders of livery companies and other organisations too, so it's intended for that audience. It's also intended for apprentices, because at this period, at the end of the 16th century, there's a lot of concern about apprentices. There are an awful lot of them. London is getting bigger through in-migration. Lots of apprentices, and concern about them running around, drinking, gambling, associating together, doing all kinds of things. So there's a lot of worry about apprentices. And it's found that tales of heroism, of valour, of chivalry, will instill some decent values in apprentices and make them behave better. So this is a work designed with different audiences in mind, but I think particularly for apprentices. And there is some evidence that apprentices actually read this bit of stuff, that these texts were circulating in print amongst apprentices through in the city of London. And the popularity of Arthurian myths, the Knights of the Round Table, all of this kind of thing is becoming really popular at the end of the 16th century. So that's a bit of context, really, as to why Johnson wrote this work. So who then were the Nine Worthies of London? And there are different kinds of worthies here. There are some names you'll see which will be familiar to possibly as famous Londoners. There are others here who are not really known to be Londoners at all, and the connection is a little bit tenuous, it has to be said. And so Johnson is establishing a link with London that is a bit dubious, as has to be said. The second thing is that throughout the lives of these characters in Johnson's work, there's a lot about their chivalric and military exploits. Some of it's just invented. So Hugh Calvin, for example, who was a silk weaver, allegedly, his main claim to fame in the Nine Words of London is that he went to Poland and he was asked to deal with a giant bear, which is terrorising the neighbourhood. So he dealt with this bear. That's his main claim to fame, from chivalric point of view. There are others here who are very well known. The first is William Walworth, the fishmonger who was mayor of London during the Peasants' Revolt. And of course, it was Walworth who killed Walter Tyler at Smithfield. And the illustration there shows Walter Tyler with a very big sword about to kill Walter Tyler. And Walworth became a celebrated figure in fishmonger company history throughout the 17th century, particularly the statue at Fishmonger's Hall from 1684. There's also a dagger at Fishmonger's Hall, which is alleged to be the dagger that was used at the time by William Walworth. Don't know. Looks to be from the right period, but who knows? So Walworth is a very famous hero in both different company history and in the City of London. Henry Pritchard, or Pickard, is known for hosting a dinner in London, and it became known as the Feast of the Five Kings, in Bintner Company history in particular. And so you can see a plaque up there about it too. Whether this dinner actually took place is a matter for conjecture. Various people, including me, have gone through to try and look at dates when different kings were in London, could it have happened. Some of them were in London, Mary Ransom, for example, King of Scotland, was in London at the time. So there is some evidence that a dinner could have happened. but we don't know who did. Going on a little bit further, William Sevenoak was a grocer, as a mayor of London again, most famous for his charity, in fact, he's had almshouses and a school. The legend of Sevenoak is that he was a foundling, so he's called William Sevenoak after the place where he was born, Sevenoaks in Kent, and of course he founded Sevenoak School. The reason he's in the list, though, is actually more to do with his alleged military exploits, which Johnson, as far as I can tell, that just makes up. He was supposed to be a soldier in the armies of Henry V in northern France. And at one point in Johnson's narrative, he actually has William Sevenoak fighting in single combat against the Dauphin of France on the battlefield, something which almost certainly didn't happen. But Johnson tells it as a story and has this whole career in a military context. The only thing we do know about Sevenoak, which may be slightly towards the more militaristic, is that he was accused of piracy on a couple of occasions due to his activities in the English Channel during the Hundred Years' War. But that's about as far as it goes, really. And then, I'm not going to go through all of them, but the last one to mention at this point is Thomas White, merchant tailor, of course, very famous for his philanthropy, one of the wealthiest men in London, if not in England, in the mid-16th century. Involved in the foundation of Merchant Tailors School, founded St John's College, Oxford, and established a huge network of charities and provincial profit towns in England, which was an extraordinary act of philanthropy. But he's in here partly because of that, but also because he happened to be Lord Mayor at the time of Wyatt's rebellion, 1553-54. And he is credited with sort of holding the city together at that point, and of course dealing with Wyatt. There was some perilous moments when the rebels came very close to London and suffered, and things could have gone very badly wrong. So he's given the credit by Johnson for sort of holding the city together and sort of defending it. So that's his military career. So I'm not going to talk about anybody else now apart from John Hawkwood. So what's Hawkwood doing here? Well, Hawkwood is, of course, a very famous, some say infamous, notorious mercenary. I've set out his career very briefly here. I don't need to talk about that because he's so famous. He fought just about anybody in Italy who paid him. He married the daughter of Visconti, Milan. So very, very successful in mercenary terms in the 14th century as captain White Company. And you can see here the fantastic equestrian memorial to him in the Duomo in Florence. It's just, if you go, it's just extraordinary size and scale of this, and to an English knight. It's just amazing. So, what's this London connection about? Well, Johnson says that John Hawkwood came from Essex, the son of Tanner, and was apprenticed as a tailor in London before going off to fight in the continent. Is this true or is it not true? There's one theory that has been presented, which is to do with his surname. It's alleged that Italians could not say the word Hawkwood, therefore they called him by different names. And it's true, in the Italian sources he's not known generally as Hawkwood, he's known as Giovanni Acuto, or Johannes Acutis in the sources. And indeed, if you remember back to the memorial, that's actually what it says, Johannes Acutis on the memorial text from 1436. So it's suggested that the Italian words acuto, acuti, correspond to needle or sharp, therefore he was a tailor. It's a bit tenuous, I have to say, but it has been a few problems. And Johnson picks up on this actually a little bit in his account, where he has a nice little rhyme. There did the Italians term me John Acute because I had their foes in such pursuit. So I think that's the theory. But what is the actual evidence that we have? Well, it's probably a bit small for something like that, but just to go through some of the examples that we have. So John Stowe, merchant tailor, right, he finds by good record this John Hawkwood was born in Essex, the son of Gilbert Hawkwood, an apprentice with a tailor in the city of London. And John Stowe, as I said, he's a merchant tailor who was the author of the Survey of London, which published in 1598. He knew the merchant tailor's records very, very well indeed. There's stuff in the Survey of London which he must have got from records of the merchant tailors, which no one could survive. So there's quite a bit of reliance, I think, on the place of him. But actually, he wasn't the first person to mention that Hawkwood was a tailor. The first person was Ralph Holinshed in 1577, a few years earlier. This man was born in Essex, some might, but no one else found him yet. And the first that became a tailor in London afterwards going into the wars in France. So that's the earliest evidence. Then there's one of an annoying gap going back to the 15th century where there's a preface in one of Caxton's works which refers to Hawkwood, but not, it doesn't mention anything about London at all, just sees Hawkwood as a good example. That's it. So then we have to go back to the 1390s and the Westminster Chronicle, written by a monk at Westminster Abbey, who notes the death of Sir John Hawkwood, the famous knight John Hawkwood, who from being a poor apprentice of a hosier in London went to Lombardy. So that's a bit of a curveball there. What's a hosier doing there? The answer is I don't know, but first of all, I think it's good evidence of a London connection in the first place. We don't know where monk at Westminster got that information from, but I think it's indicative, I think, of a London connection. Hosiers make items of clothing, so it could be a confusion somewhere around the precise location. We don't know. This was, you know, a number of years after Hawkwood may or may not have been an apprentice. So we don't know. But I think it's interesting that at the time of Hawkwood's death, he was being talked about as a poor apprentice in London. And then finally, just another London connection is in property. Hawkwood did have interest in London, including in the site of what's now the Leather Hall, just up the road from here. So his London connections were not just the speculative, they were grounded in reality. So we don't know, but I think there was some interesting evidence to show that he may well have been, as many people who came to London as an apprentice and possibly decided it wasn't for him, but fighting people, wanted to go to the continent. But I think for me, some of the most interesting things to find out about him are about his sort of later life, you know, in the 17th century, where we have a number of works that are published, that celebrate Hawkwood in the context of merchant tailor history. So the first one is called The Honourable Prentice, or This Tailor is a Man, shown in the life and death of Sir John Hawkwood, sometime apprentice of London. In 1624, there is a wonderful pageant that's set up for as part of the mayoral procession for Sir John Gore, merchant tailor. And it's commissioned from John Webster, so that's a series of investments. And it features a number of historical characters in merchant tailor history, and Hawkwood is one of those, so he's given a special place. And then finally, in 1665, the merchant tailors may have commissioned this, but nonetheless, it was written for a work by William Stanley called The Honour of the Merchant Tailors, where it was set forth the noble acts, valiant deeds, and heroic performances of merchant tailors in former ages, their honourable loves and mighty adventures. So again, moving back to Johnson all about chivalry, but this time introducing other elements to it, their honourable loves, for example. Now, I think also the slide on the right-hand side, because one of the themes I think I'm running through a lot of this is actually about behaviour, about how tailors should behave, and particularly because tailors have such a sort of close relationship with their customers. And you can see on the right hand side some tailors sitting on their shop boards at the top of the image from Thomas Stanley's book. And then below there is a tailor very carefully approaching a female customer. So I think it's actually something about behaviour of apprentices, of tailors generally, towards their customers. So the virtues of being a knight, courtly values, I think, quite important in that context. So I think that's something that runs through all of these, it's worth in a very interesting way. And then finally, I just want to sort of quote from Win Stanley at the end, who obviously was either pro-merchant tailor or was paid to be pro-merchant tailor, where he says, and thus, gentle reader, we briefly showed you the noble achievements of some few of the renowned society of merchant tailors. To enumerate them all would require more than one man's life to set them. At that point, I'll hand over to Karen. He did marry a woman called Alice Fitzwarren,
but in fact she was not the daughter of a London mercer. She was the daughter of Sir Ivan Fitzwarren, who was a knight in Dorset. He married Alice, and she died in about 1409, and he didn't marry again. Now that's unusual because they didn't have children, or any no surviving children, and most London merchants in that class married many times in the hope of having lots of children, particularly second marriages, they often married widows. He was indeed a very successful mercer, and particularly he sold great quantities of silks. A mercer dealt with imported silks and so on from the continent, cloth of gold, velvets, that kind of thing. And he sold huge quantities of this material to Richard II, and there's a wardrobe account which was exhibited in Dunstan's Hall recently from the National Archives, which is a wardrobe account for Richard II's 1392 to 5, those years, and Richard II supplied £3,500 worth of mercery. It's a fantastic amount of cloth of gold and silk and that sort of thing. That was the making of his fortune, being a good mercer, a successful mercer, and his alliance with a king who loved beautiful things, named Richard II. He lent money to the crown, particularly to the Lancastrians, to Henry IV and Henry V, but he was able to repay. There was no evidence that the king, he had ever burnt the bonds in which the king was obligated to. He certainly collected the money that he lent. I don't think he lent it usuriously. I think he lent it to a public role that he played, and also to get other sorts of privileges. He was repaid usually on tallies on the London customs accounts. He was extremely rich, but, and the interesting thing about him is that unlike most London merchants, he didn't buy land outside London, perhaps because he came from a landed family. If insofar as he bought property in London. He didn't buy an estate and make himself as it were a country gentleman, which is what most London merchants who were successful did do at this period. Instead, he kept his wealth in liquid form, property in London, but also in plate and in jewels, clothing, all sorts of valuable, probably valuable mercery as well. When he died, his executors had about £5,000 actually, as it were, in cash or in objects. And that is what was the basis of his fortune, but also the basis of his reputation. Because his will, which is, he doesn't mention, he mentions lots of things in his will, very few individual people. I think he was a bit of a cold fish. He doesn't mention individual requests of any kind, but his executors, and the most important one was a man called John Carpenter, who was the town clerk or common clerk of London in the period when, I should have said, he did become mayor of London 3 times. And in his final mayoralty, John Carpenter was the clerk of London town clerk. Very learned man with a very large library of his own, probably the leading intellectual, the main intellectual of the 15th century London. And he was one of Whittington's executors. I think he used Whittington's wealth with the other executors to buy lands in London, more lands in London, and they spent money on a lot of projects, like rebuilding Newgate Jail, repairing St. Bartholomew's Hospital, building a public lavatory at Lintry called Whittington's Longhouse, 64 seats for men and 64 seats for women. There were also almshouses above. I'm not sure how desirable the almshouses. But anyway, that he was they spent a lot of money on it, and particularly on Guildhall Library, which was built with Whittington's wealth. But what was really interesting about what Carpenter did with Whittington's money, he didn't invest, hand it over to the church to found Whittington's almshouses and Whittington College for priests. He handed it to the Mercer's Company, which meant that it was, although some of it was taken away at the time of the Reformation, it was much more secure. And I have to say that endowment, which has been for the most part of charitable work, produces now some millions of pounds every year. It is an amazing endowment, and it survived all that time. Now, the reason that it's, that in a sense, not the reason it survived, but when, because his benefactions carried his name, particularly the College of Priests and the almshouse. The College of Priests went to the Reformation. The almshouse continued to be called not the Mercer's almshouse, but Whittington's almshouse. It carried his name, and so when the sort of legend mentioned that Matthew was describing in the late 16th century begins to circulate, you know, he wasn't actually listed as one of your worthies, but he might have been, the name of Whittington is in people's minds. People know about Whittington because of the benefactions which carried his name. And this legend of a cat bringing good fortune appears first in the, well, it appears in the 15th, but in London in the late 16th century, same time as Johnson. And we find this tale of a cat bringing fortune different ways. I mean, we still have the keys of a black cat, of course, it's our path. In Germany and France and other countries. And the first references in London are actually to a play in 1604. It was licensed as a ballad, the story of Whittington, embellished with an edition of the cat. And there were various versions in the 17th century. And as I said, the reason for this is because his name had been kept alive by the nature of his benefactions. And also, if you have a slide, you'll see on the left here an engraving by William Elstrack, who was a London engraver, born about 1570, and this is a copy of a portrait of when I say a portrait, a drawing of Richard Whittington, which was done in 1536. It doesn't survive anymore. Elstrack made this engraving, and you see that Whittington has his hand on a scarf. That was a very common motif you'll find in the 16th century painting, portrait of people holding a scarf. It didn't sell very well, so he changed it and replaced the scarf with a cat. Now, did Elstrack's replacement of the skull with a cat provoke the attachment of the cat legend to Whittington, or was he reflecting already the fact that the cat is attached to Whittington's name? I don't know which came first. I like to think that maybe it was because Elstrack thought, what will make this engraving more attractive? What's the right size and shape? And I have to say, it's not the most attractive cat I've ever seen. But so, maybe it's better than a scarf. So that is the Whittington legend. There's quite a lot of truth in it, but a lot has been embellished. Particularly, I'm afraid I can find no evidence of Hopper for the cat in Whittington's lifetime. People have tried to find evidence of the Whittington had a cat. All I can offer you is that his brother's son, his nephew, was a merchant in Bristol, because they came from Gloucestershire, and he imported lions for the court of Edward IV. Not a cat, but a lion. That's the best I can do.
tea was came aboard. So this is the idea that her mistress, she came as a servant in London to the merchant and his wife. Her mistress died, and then she married her master. And then he then died and left her a wealthy widow. She married again to someone called Henry Gould. And then her third and final husband was Sir John Percival, Royal Mayor of London, the first merchant tailor of London. So that's the story, which is already in print in 1602. But interestingly, not in London, but this is in Cornwall. So she's quite famous in the parish, in the county of her birth, but not really in London, she's really here in London sources this time. So again, sticking with Cornwall, and jumping forward to the late 19th, early 20th century, we get to get Milton booming at this point, I'm afraid. The year 1463, a tall and portly merchant in the distinctive apparel of the times, rode along the wilds of the Cornish Moor. He sat high and firm upon his horse, the bone of gelding, with a double peaked saddle, a broad beaver, which was then called the farmer's hat, shaded a grave with thoughtful countenance. And you get to just it goes on like this for a long time. There, on the green and rushy knoll, a earthy knoll of windswept tree, a damsel in the blossom of her stood leaning on her shepherd's staff. And it just goes on. So this is the, you know, this has become part of the Cornish legend. And this book, Footprints of Former Men, in far Cornwall includes giants and all sorts of figures from Cornish history, but it includes Tomasine here as well. So what truth is there in any of this? Well, we've been able to reconstruct her heritage, her career, her husband's in this way. So she was from Cornwall. Her parents were sort of minor gentry, a bit, you know, not quite as the Whittingtons, but reasonably well connected. Both her parents were buried in Kent, eventually, because her parents followed their eldest son, Richard, who was a rector in Chelsfield in Kent. So they must have at some point moved from Cornwall to Kent to be with their son. And we know largely from Thomasine's own will, and how I mentioned the sources, and Thomasine had a wonderful will that she made in 1512. This sort of gifts and requests she made to her family, remember them in prayers and masses, all sorts of things. So we know about her as siblings. We also know that she did indeed have three husbands. Firstly, Henry Gould, citizen and tailor. Second one, Thomas Barnaby, citizen and tailor. Thirdly, John Percival, So she married three members of the Taylor's Company, Merchant Taylor's Company, in succession. So she's very, very interested, and I think there are some similar sort of stories with other delivery companies as well. She became extraordinarily wealthy as a result. She outlived Sir John Percival by 9 years, and when she died, she established a grammar school, Queen St Mary in Cornwall. The statutes were based on the statutes of her husband's school, Sir John Percival's school, which was in Macclesfield, now known as King's School, Macclesfield. It was Macclesfield Grammar School when he founded it after his death in 1503. So she drew very much on the statutes of her husband's school. And you can see here some detail that the schoolmaster had to be sufficiently learned in grammar, graduated from Oxford and Cambridge, so he's a Master of Arts or a Master of Grammar at the very least. And then in terms of education, the school set out that without asking or demanding of the said children or any of the friends any money or any reward in such teaching. In other words, the tuition was free, it was all funded through the endowments that she left to the trust that was to run the school. It wasn't left to the company, it was left to a group of trustees, in fact, to the minister, 19 trustees and 4 governors. The problem with the school was that it was in the East St Mary, a tiny parish, and by the time of the Reformation, it was already struggling, had very few pupils there, and so there wasn't much incentive to refound it, as many schools were. So John Percival's school was refounded as King's School, as so many other schools were. the Reformation, because there was a need for it, there wasn't really a need for the schooling in this area. So it sort of struggled on for a bit, but that's it, then closed. But we do have the school building. This is still there. You can go and stay there. It's a landmark trust property. So if you ever wanted to go stay in the current stay there, you can go and rent it. So this is a wonderful example of a 16th century provincial grammar school. So it's really fabulous. So there is then a lot of truth in the myth, if you like, the story of Thomasine Bonaventure, which she was born, Thomasine Percival, as she died. And you can sort of see it reflected in a different way. So on the left you've got a horrendous image of Thomasine, looking a bit like Marie Antoinette, keeping his teeth on the wall, seeing this sort of like 18th century character on the walls passing by. So it's still very much alive in Weeksit Mary. This is part of their sort of what they celebrate in Weeksit Mary and Cornwall today, and this is part of the local publication. But she's also important for those of us who study in London. And you know, I wrote about her in a volume of Many London Widows, which Caroline edited a number of years ago. So I hope that and she appears in an encyclopedia of early modern English literature. So she's sort of getting the fame and fortune, if you like, that I think she deserves, not just in Cornwall but also in London too. And I think, you know, recently the Merchant Taylors have established a dinner called the Thomasine Percival lunch, beautiful lunch. I think it'd be great to get back to the one who's sort of have a Thomasine Percival scholarship or something. So I think she's a remarkable woman, and that's, you know, we can just see that in her will and her request and her interest in education in particular. She brought up children in her household who were not her own children. She never had any children of her own, but she brought up children of arms, as it says in her will. In her own household. So she had a very charitable disposition. So I'm going to leave it there. I think we're due to go and have a good conversation. And look forward to questions.